Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. I want to preach a message tonight that I just simply entitled, Does Doctrine Really Matter? Does Doctrine Really Matter? And, you know, if there wasn't, you know, you could teach on this, and I say, well, I know about that. Yeah, but the one thing that always strikes me is the fact that there tends to be, as time goes on, a willingness, clearly on the part of the world, but even so, in the part of so-called Bible believers, where they're willing to compromise doctrinal beliefs for the sake of getting along or attracting new people or whatever the reason might be. And doctrine suffers. And, you know, there are many things in the Word of God that I suppose are not, as far as our lives are concerned, as important as others. But when it comes to doctrine, those are the crucial issues. That's the foundation. And if the foundation be destroyed, what are the righteous going to do? Doctrine is vitally important. And I mentioned this morning in 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16 and 17, Paul said, all scripture, and I want you to be reminded of this. Paul is winding down in 2 Timothy. That's the last of his writings. So if you just try to put yourself into his position, he's trying to come up with all the, what am I going to tell this young preacher here before I exit? They're going to cut my head off, and I've got to leave him with something. So he makes these kinds of statements as parting words. And he says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. And the first thing he says it's profitable for is doctrine. Now, doctrine may not be important to some people. It may not be important to different denominations and all, but it's important to God. And it was important enough for Paul to recognize that and pass that on to Timothy, a faithful man who would be able to convey that to others as well. In Titus chapter 2, in verse 7 and 8, again, Paul said, all things showing thyself a pattern of good works in doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned. That's the kind of doctrine. That's the emphasis that Paul was placing upon this thing called doctrine. Again, going back to 2 Timothy chapter 4, the very last of the things that Paul wrote, the last chapter, he said, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. He said, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Why? For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Now, when that began, I don't know. It's probably always kind of gone on. But we're certainly there today. I've actually seen advertisements and TV commercials about certain churches, and they advertise, are you tired of doctrine? Well, and they invite people to come because we're not going to place any emphasis on doctrine. Well, if you're not going to place any emphasis on doctrine, I don't know what you're left with. Entertainment? He said, but the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts will they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. That's what they'll do. That'll be the alternative to doctrine. They'll say, no. Yeah, you know what we'd like? Pastor, could you tell us about this? Could you tell us about fairy tales? He said, What fairy tales? Well, that's what it goes on to say. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. There's preachers standing in pulpits. I don't know what they're giving people. And it's sad to me that the thing that God considers to be of ultimate importance regarding the Word of God is taking on, as time goes on, as Christianity apostatizes, it's just getting less and less important and more offensive. Oh, there he goes with that doctrine again. Well, in these days of theological confusion and ecumenical compromise, what's the Bible position for the Bible believer to assume toward heretics and false religious teachers? Are we supposed to patronize them? Are we supposed to associate with them? Are we supposed to accept their sponsorship, increase their numbers, send them converts, add to their prestige, follow their leadership, identify their churches? Obliterate important biblical distinctions? I would say no. What is a heretic? Well, I'll tell you, in a nutshell, a heretic is somebody that won't adhere to sound doctrine or will alter the doctrine of the Word of God in order to make it more palatable for people to receive, less offensive. A person under any religion, but particularly the Christian, who holds and teaches opinion repugnant to the established faith or that which is made the standard of orthodoxy. Doctrine matters. And a person that won't do it, I'm not suggesting that we resort to medieval ways and burn heretics at the stake, but they did once upon a time. That's the seriousness that they took this. It's like, we can't have people running around town as heretics, disrupting the faith. 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 18 and 19 says, "For first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. For there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you." Paul was worried about heresies. And of course, what happens when you have heretics in the assembly? Well, you end up with divisions. Because some people are going to say, well, that's not what the Bible says. And others say, well, we don't really care what the Bible says. 2 Peter 2 and verse 1 says, "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction." You know, one of the areas, notice it says, even denying the Lord that bought them. That's directly pointed at the gospel and the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Some would even deny that, exchanging the gospel message for something like, well, just do the best you can and you'll be all set. Now that'll go, you can sell that. People, they'll sign up for that one in a heartbeat. But the doctrinal position of the Word of God as it relates to salvation is, you're a sinner. And the wages of sin is death. Don't say that. Well, it's the truth. But Jesus Christ, here's the good news. Jesus Christ came into the world, suffered, bled, and died for the sins of the world. And since salvation is by grace and through faith, when you trust that and trust that alone, he'll give you the gift of everlasting life. It's all based on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Yeah, like Peter was worried. Yeah, he said that there's going to be a time when they'll creep in. Yeah, I like that when God says that they'll creep in. And I've always thought about that. And I thought, you know, what do you call somebody that creeps in? A creep. I guess another title for that, a message like that, would be creeps in the church. Probably a lot of creeps in churches. But you know, there are individuals that were martyred because their doctrinal position was adherence to the Bible and not to some man-made creed, not to some religious organization. Whether it was Wycliffe or Huss or Savonarola or Tyndale and countless other men and women that gave their lives for the cause of Christ and would not bend or bow to any individual or organization that would command them to do differently. Does doctrine really matter? Oh, it, like I said before, it may not matter to some folks. It may not even matter to many of the modern mainline denominations, but it matters to God, and it matters to me. And because it matters to me, I have to repeatedly, or at least periodically, stress this point, that doctrine matters. Because I've had conversations with some people recently, people who are claiming to be Bible believers, that are willing to compromise doctrinal, biblical positions in order to satisfy other needs. And I say, fooey on you. I won't do it. I won't. What does God say that we're to do with, well, what does he call somebody that will not acknowledge the truth, that will not endure sound doctrine? He says they're a heretic. And God said that we're to do some things with heretics. Number one, he says to try them. In 1 John 4 and verse 1, he said, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they be of God, because many false prophets are going out into the world." You put them to the test. How do you put them to the test? You line up what they're saying and what they're preaching with the Bible. And if it doesn't line up, then, well, we'll see as we go on. Philippians 1 and verse 9 and 10 says, "In this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are excellent." I'll tell you what's excellent. Doctrine is excellent. The second thing that he said that we're to do with a heretic is not only to try them, but to mark them. Mark them. Put a mark on them. Point your finger at them and identify them for what they are. Romans 16, 17 says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them." He didn't just say identify them. He went on and said that you are to avoid them. Philippians 3 and verse 17 and 18 says, "Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so, as you have us for an example." There's good examples, there's bad examples. And every one of us needs to be marked. I don't mind bearing the mark of Bible banger. "Oh, you're one of those Bible bangers." Well, what are you, trying to offend me? Sounds like a compliment to me. Because what is it actually saying? Somebody that believes the Bible. I believe the book. My eternal soul is resting on the contents of what the book says. And so I'm just going to take it all from Genesis to Revelation and believe the whole thing. He said to try them. Put them to the test. "Oh, you say you believe this? You say we don't have to do that? You say that this isn't right? This isn't a responsibility of ours? Do you have a chapter and verse on that?" See, I'm willing to change anything that I believe if somebody says, "Well, you know, preacher, look at this. The Bible says this." All right, well, I stand corrected. But if I'm going up against a heretic and their attitude is, "Well, I just think..." Well, I don't care, and neither does God care what you think. He said, the Lord gave the word. He said, "Great was the company of them that published it." He said, try them. He said, mark them. He went a step further. He said, I'll tell you something else you ought to do with them. Rebuke them. Somebody wants to get out of order like that? He said, don't let them just, you don't just say to them, well, that's nice. He said, rebuke them. Again, where? Titus chapter 1 in our text here, a little further on down in verse 10 to 13. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped. Got to be silenced. Who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake, just for a paycheck. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said the Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. He said, this witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith. When people go astray, you don't cut them any slack. You call them on it. To rebuke means to scold or to reprimand. Make them cry. Proverbs 9 and verse 7 says, he that reproveth a scorner getteth to himself shame, and he that rebuketh a wicked man getteth himself a blot. Proverbs 27:5, open rebuke is better than secret love. Proverbs 28:23, he that rebuketh a man afterward shall find more favor than he that flattereth with the tongue. I mean, think about it. If you let a heretic get away, the Bible says, answer not a fool according to his folly, lest thou be like unto him. And then it says, answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit. You're going to have to pick and choose what you're going to do there. But in essence, God's saying, don't let it go. Don't let it go. Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 5 says, it is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. Tell you something else he says to do with them. Well, I'll tell you, this is what God says to do with a heretic. And I think the Bible defines a heretic rather well. It would be, I mean, there are probably other things that we could lump into the definition, but anyone that avoids or destroys or reinterprets sound doctrine, God, that's a heretic. That's a heretic. And God gave us some instruction as to what to do with them. Does doctrine really matter? Boy, I'll tell you, it must. It must if God is saying, if you find a heretic, do this. Now, he didn't say, get out a shotgun and send them to eternity. But you just can't let that go. Try them, mark them, rebuke them. He said, have no fellowship with them. Have no fellowship with them. Ephesians 5:11, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. He said in 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 14, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? I'll tell you something else he says. He said, withdraw thyself. Withdraw thyself. Don't wait for them to go away, because they won't. If you put a stamp of approval on their heresy, then they'll stick around with you. They'll think you're one of them. But he said, you have the responsibility to withdraw yourself from them. And again, you don't have to be mean and nasty. You don't have to say, I hate you. Just say, you know, I understand that's your position. We're living in America. You can believe whatever you want. But that's not what the Bible teaches, and that's not what I believe, and so I'm not going to be a part of that. Withdraw thyself. 2 Thessalonians 3:6. Now we command you, brethren. Sound like a suggestion? No. We command you, brethren, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly, and not after the tradition which ye have received of us. Tell you what, folks. I've seen too much compromise over doctrinal issues. If it has something to do with, you know, the facilities and the decor, I suspect we're all going to have to give and take and a lot of these things. But when it comes to doctrine, man, I'll tell you what, I would pack my bags in a second and get out of a church that did not believe this book as at least the way that I understood it. I wouldn't sit back and say, well, I don't agree with him on this. I think he's wrong on this. And before I would go around and sow discord among the brethren and say, psh, 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 you know, the pastor, he's not right on that, you know. I'd get out of that church. I'd go find me a church, and if I couldn't find one, some people, sadly, are never going to find a church. The only way that they're going to agree with somebody is if they start it themselves. And even then, they probably will have a fight with themselves. But he said here, have no fellowship with them, withdraw thyself. He said, turn away from them. 2 Timothy 3 and verse 5, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And by the way, the gospel is the power, right? Denying the power thereof, he said, from such, turn away. Turn away. It doesn't, there's nothing in here that says in the Bible, well, you know, there is a verse. There is a verse that I suppose we could throw out there and make a justification, except for the fact that even that one, he says, as much as lieth in you, we're to live peaceably with all men. But can you actually get along for the sake of getting along with people who are diametrically opposed to this book and the gospel? I mean, you're not even on the same page. I'll tell you something else he said to do. He said, receive them not. That's what he said. 2 John verse 10 and 11, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive them not into your house. What doctrine? Well, the doctrine laid out, you know, that's why when all of these cults are going around knocking at your door and unsuspecting people say, oh yeah, come on in. God say, no, you don't invite them in. What's wrong with you? Remember how back in Genesis chapter 3, the serpent, he was the most subtle of the beasts? Well, I'll tell you what, when the cults come knocking at your door, they're about as subtle as the devil. And you think they're going to say, what religion you belong to anyway? Oh, one of those. Well, I'll tell you, you're wrong. They're not going there. They're going to be real nice. They'll say something like, would you like to live forever on the planet Earth? He said, receive them not. Let me interject this thought for a second. You know what I think is really, I guess, the basis for all of this is we have to know what we believe. Oh, yeah, that's an issue. Because I think much of Bible-believing Christianity couldn't explain their way out of a paper bag when it comes to their doctrinal belief. Or they would be talked out of it in an instant. But see, if we're going to respond the way that God says to with a heretic, try them and mock them and rebuke them and have no fellowship with them and withdraw thyself from them and turn away from them and receive them not, then you're going to have to be able to identify it. Because if you can't identify it, you won't even know. He also said, have no company with them. Don't have them in your house. Don't go out to lunch with them. 2 Thessalonians 3:14. And if any man obey not our word by this epistle, note that man and have no company with him, that he may be ashamed. If we just let everyone think that, well, you know, remember what the problem was back in the book of Judges? And it ended on this note. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's where we are today. That's where we are in Christianity. It doesn't matter, well, it doesn't really matter what you believe. Just as long as we all get together and we can enjoy each other's company and drink coffee and eat donuts and, you know, we'll be back next week. There's no likelihood of me living any of this thing. I just go there, and so that's why there's a shift even in the preaching time gets less and less, and the music time gets more and more, because it's turned into an entertainment center. But he said, have no company with them. He went on and said, again in Titus, he said, reject them. He said, a man, Titus 3:10, that is a heretic, after the first and second admonition, reject. I mean, give him the benefit of the doubt. Some people just have never grown, have never learned. But if you've told them once and told them twice, then he said, reject. Now, I know that that doesn't sound nice. But it just tells me, does doctrine really matter? I guess it does, because God's given us an awful lot of things to do when we encounter someone that is not doctrinally straight. Ecclesiastes 3:6 says that there's a time to keep and there's a time to cast away. Now he says one more thing too. He said, be ye separate. Now, separation is not isolation, but rather distinction. There's a distinction between things, and things that are not the same. Think about that for a second. If they're not the same, then they're not equal. And a lot of people think that, well, the fine details don't matter. Just as long as it's a general principle of things. No. Jesus talked about every jot and tittle. I mean, he got right down to the nitty gritty, the finest points. He said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will not pass away. And so we're going to take God at his word. And if somebody can't do that, and if somebody won't adhere to that, then I guess we have to separate from them. 2 Corinthians 6:17 says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Does doctrine really matter? Well, it matters to me. And you have to determine whether or not it matters to you. But it ought to matter to you, at least in the sense of not being hypocritical. Why go and sing the songs and amen the verses if you don't agree with it? If you don't agree with it, then not that, I mean, you ought to get it right, but if you can't do that, then go find a place that believes like you believe. You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to...